Resonance on 104.4 FM and DAB Radio, Radio Player, and online at resonancefm.com.
Well, look at this! Here's the guy here just in the nick of time! What does that make us?
Big damn heroes, sir!
Ain't we just!
Now that's a bit of a problem. See, rumor has it, the Athenians have already turned you down. And if those philosophers and boy lovers have found that kind of nerve, then...
We must be diplomatic.
And of course, Spartans have the reputation to consider.
Choose your next words carefully, Leonidas. They may be your last as king.
Provide him with suitable weapons. Weapons of divine temper. A helmet, a shield, a sword.
Find and fulfill your destiny.
Hello and welcome to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM, a film and TV radio show where a handful of film enthusiasts shoot the breeze about all things film and television. I'm Marcus E. Acco. And...
Again,
yes. Okay, but I'm going to throw it out there. The streaming show that I want to recommend because I am obsessed with is Good Omens on Amazon Prime.
Really?
Yeah. Take it away and we'll talk about it. Go on.
Okay. Good evening. I'm David Campbell. And just being thrown for a lovely little loop there.
Don't you love it when I do that?
Yeah,
it's just,
you do that all the time.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Streaming show that I will recommend. There's one on Ancient Greece that I'm watching.
What is it called?
Ancient Greece.
There you go. Excellent.
So it's just been repeated on BBC iPlayer.
Excellent. And with us in the studio, she's a producer, actress, and ambassador for Dior. Please tell us your name and whatever TV show or film that you want to recommend. It's on a streaming series right now.
Hey there, it's Diane Paras with you now. I would say, actually, I would agree with you. Good
okay.
Omens.
Yes.
Yeah, a bit of diabolical, a bit of angelic, and at the same time, a very good mix.
Absolutely. I read the book ages ago. Michael Amaria, he recommended I read the book. He's the one, he's a friend of the show. Friend is a loose term. No, I'm kidding. He's a friend of the show. And we go back way, so many years, and he recommends tons of books for me, right? And one of the books that he recommended when we were back in school was Good Omens, Terry Pratchett and Neil Gaiman. And those of you who don't know the story, it's basically about the end of the world, and there's an angel and a demon who pretty much work together to try and stop that from happening. And in the Amazon series, I don't know anybody else they could have cast in those roles except Michael Sheen and David Tennant. David, you kind of reacted when I said Good Omens. Have you seen it? And two, did you like it if you did see it? Or what was with the reaction?
The reaction is that I'm seeing it heavily bombarded on TV.
You
need to watch this, blah, 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 Amazon Prime. Uh-huh. You know, and it's like every advert break that comes on, it's there. So I was like, oh.
Sure. I see. Okay. I understand what you're saying. It doesn't need a plug from us because at the end of the day, it's not exactly struggling, right? So it's,
you know what I mean?
Yeah, fair enough. It's not struggling. Tons of people like it. The fact that you have Michael Sheen and David Tennant on top form, it doesn't need me to. I'm going to add one extra viewer to it. I could recommend other things like When They See Us, which is on Netflix, but that's also getting a big push. And one of the reasons why Diana, have you seen the Netflix show When They See Us?
I have Amazon Prime on my phone. I have to say I'm a bit addicted. In the beginning when I saw the trailer, I was a bit, oh, okay, this is interesting.
This is for Good Omens you're talking about.
Yes,
okay,
exactly. Yeah. And the first show that I watched, it was purely out of curiosity.
Sure.
just to make sure and see exactly what the show was all about. Mm-hmm. And I was hooked after that.
Yeah.
David Tennant, Doctor Who. Okay, I think that's a perfect choice, right?
Absolutely. we've got people listening in and watching on Facebook Live on Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM on Facebook. Connor Brown just messaged in saying, I think Good Omens is great. Absolutely. Man with taste there. You're absolutely right. I was already in, as I said. Michael O'Mara lent me the book. I read it, loved it. I was like, this has to be made. I will watch it. I heard it was being made about a year ago. I heard David Tennant and Michael Sheen were going to be in it. I love both of them. I think they're amazing, and I knew I was going to be in as soon as I started watching it. 3 minutes in. 3 minutes in. They haven't even popped up on screen, and I'm like, take my money. I don't care. Take all my money. I will defend you to the end, which is the reason why, David, when you were making that face, I was about to say, no, me and you are going to fight fisticuffs. But you pulled it back. You haven't seen it yet, David, have you?
No, I haven't had the chance.
Go and check it out. Okay. Go and check it out. Give Amazon your money.
Who wrote it?
Neil Gaiman and David and Terry Pratchett. They wrote the book, the right? Book. I don't know.
Is it one book or a series?
No, it's one book. It's one book. Everything is just in that one book. Right. But its series obviously is about 10 episodes. So and it's every episode. They might add a little bit. They do. They actually did. They added some extra characters. I think it's been ages since I read the book, but I don't think Angel Gabriel's in the book. But he's in the series and played by John Hamm, wonderfully by John Hamm. Again, another person I love. I mean, they went into my brain and said, who are people that if we pop them on screen, this guy is going to say, I'm going to watch it. And they found a lot of them. Not everyone, but they found a lot of them and they put them on there. Michael McKean. You know him from This Is Spinal Tap. If you've watched Better Call Saul, he's Saul Goodman's brother. He's in there, and it's like amazing, amazing cast. Go and check it out. Anyway, I've ranted a little bit too much about this show, about not the show, but the show itself on Amazon. You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
With us in the studio is actress, producer, and ambassador for Dior, who she'll be telling us more about that later on, Diane Paras.
Yeah.
How you doing, Diana? Diane, you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay. How are you?
I'm doing very well. I am excited to be back in the studio. It's been a while.
Yeah, you can say that.
Yeah, it has definitely. It's been a while since I've been back in the studio. We've done some pre-records and some repeats, etc. But now I'm back and I'm energized. I'm happy to keep charging on. We will charge on. We'll talk to you, Dan, about some of your projects that you're working on in a few minutes. We'll do our top five favorites category, which is at the end of the show. And this week, our top fives are films and TV shows about the history of Greece. We'll talk about that later on. But before any of that stuff, producer Dave, film and TV news. Michael Burhan, we feel the love too. Thank you very much. Michael Burhan is he's the other me, who basically is the guy who replaces me whenever I am not in the studio. He comes in and he takes over. So producer David is just popping out. He knew it's his segment that's next, but he's like, no, oh, I'm gonna go do something. So he's run off. So I'm gonna fill in some while he's gone, and I'm gonna talk about one of the things that. And Diane, I'll throw this to you as well. Have you heard about the? I'm assuming that you've heard the news about Robert Pattinson taking over as the Batman. Have you heard that news?
Actually, no. Okay. He's going to be replacing... Oh, my word.
Absolutely. So, for those of you who don't know, I don't know who doesn't know. Apparently, Diane, you don't know this.
Yeah.
Robert Pattinson, a.k.a. Edward... What's his name from Twilight?
Twilight.
Not a good reference to go with, yep. I'll be honest. But he's an amazing actor. He's done a whole bunch of other stuff that low-budget indie films which show his true talent, which is why a lot of people are saying, no, he's going to be terrible. And I think, no, he's not going to be terrible. I'm putting money down. Actually, I'm not putting money.
You can put a bet, you know.
I already have a bet. I already have a bet. Funny you should say that. I have a number of bets going on. Two people in particular.
Oh my gosh! Okay, so I'm gonna be the third one.
Would you like to put a bet?
Yeah, no problem.
All right. So here's the thing. So I don't encourage gambling per se, right? I'm not gonna be encouraging gambling. What I'm gonna do is I'll tell you what the other two bets are,
mm-hmm.
and then you are going to decide if you want to partake and you step in and you lay the stakes. Okay.
Okay.
So The first one is with it's Michael O'Maria. He's my nemesis. I've mentioned him before on the show. I've mentioned him a bit, but yes, we have a bet going on. He disagrees with me, and I am on the other side. I think Robert Pattinson will be amazing. He says maybe not so much. The other person is my brother. He's also been on the show, Ella Acko. He has a bet with me as well. His the stakes that Ella had placed were that if I were to lose, and critically it is said that Robert Pattinson is a terrible Batman when he obviously does the role, that I will actually, you know what? What I would do is I would put on web, as we have this, the web stream and Facebook Live, I'll have a sign that says, I will be Robert Pattinson's girlfriend. That's basically on Facebook. And obviously the movie's coming out next year, so there's still a long, long time to go. So people would have forgotten it, unless you listen to this, but it's fine. If you see me in about a year's time, right now, doing the Facebook live stream with a poster that says, I would be Robert Pattinson's girlfriend, you know that I lost. I lost that bet. So that's that one. The alternative, the reverse, if I win, he gets to do the same thing. So I'm going to drag him onto this show. He's going to do exactly the same thing, and he's going to have that sign. Maybe I'm going to make it into a T-shirt where he's going to wear it, and we're going to show it. We'll put it on Instagram. We'll put it everywhere. So, and that's basically what that bet is.
I was going to say that. You better bring him to the show and actually do that.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. The reverse, now with this is with Michael and Maria, our bet is the same sort of stakes, where I feel that Rob Pattinson will be great. He doesn't. And his the stakes are essentially, if he were to win, then we always go to Comic-Con every year. We try to go to Comic-Con every year, and we dress up. We obviously go in, and I'll give him this. When Michael goes to Comic-Con, he goes to Comic-Con. The last time he went to Comic-Con, he went as who did he go as? Oh, he went as One Punch Man, Saitama from the show One Punch Man. The one before, he went as Black Panther, and he was amazing. Ooh. He commits. Oh,
that's quite a
exactly.
quite a challenge.
He commits. No, he worked it. It's good. Michael, see, I pay you compliments. Don't say anything. Anyway, so if he wins this time, I'm going to go to Comic-Con in an outfit of his choosing, which will involve a lot of skimply dressed, whatever.
Are you sure about that?
I'm down for it, right? I'm down for whatever
okay,
he wants to.
Okay, that's part of the bet.
Exactly, whatever he wants to suggest as a dress, I will happily go with. If I win, however, he gets to go to Comic-Con as Selina Kyle, Catwoman, dressed in full cat suit, right? And Halle Berry cat suit, by the way, Halle Berry Selina Kyle, and he has to have a sign that says, "Our Pats." I will be your Catwoman anytime. Or I'll be your Selina Kyle anytime. That's the bet.
Will he have to wear a corset to make sure he gets into?
Oh, you haven't seen. Oh, okay, so this is going to be me praising Michael, and he's going to get a big head about this. But he's pretty toned up. He does martial arts and a whole bunch of other stuff. So he keeps himself tight. That's it, I'll put it that way. So put it this way: when he dressed, this is the reason I went with the Selina Kyle outfit, because he's going to enjoy it too, which is why I know that he's not going to back out. And I have full faith that Rob Pattinson's going to nail it.
Right? I love Selina, though. I love that part. Uh-huh. Seriously.
So having heard that, Diane, do you still want to take a stake in this bet? Do you want
to? I will do it.
Okay.
I will do it.
So I'll as you're the guest, mm-hmm. I will leave it to you to decide what the stakes should be. I'm going 3 for 3. I'm saying Robert Pattinson is going to knock it out of the park as Batman.
Are you sure? So basically, you're saying that Pattinson is going to be better than Christian Bale and better than Michael Keaton.
Here's the thing: when you say better than, that's subjective, right? So the way we're doing the scale is we're going to look at like Rotten Tomatoes, we're going to look at critics' views and so on.
I see.
And if we have at least 70% of critics saying that Robert Pattinson nailed it, I win. Anything below 70%, if it's 50-50, I lose. That's how high I'm putting it up, right?
Okay.
70% have to say he nailed it, and then I win. Anything less, I lose.
I'm kind of looking forward to this.
Do you want to?
No. I'm just looking forward.
You want to go?
No. I'm looking forward to the results, sure. You know, so I can actually see you in your cat suit or whatever.
Well, whatever, Michael. And you know, Michael is gonna go all out.
We need to get him on the show.
Absolutely, yes. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. We'll bring him back. We're building this up, so we'll bring him back. Okay. So, Diane, do you still want to take this?
I was gonna say the same. Yes, I was gonna say the same thing. I was picturing.
The cat suit.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
So if I lose, I wear a cat suit.
Yeah.
Okay. On the show. Fair enough. Okay. I'll take that. If I lose, we'll invite you back on the show.
Yeah.
And then
definitely.
You're gonna come back on, and I'm gonna be wearing a cat suit. I'm gonna do the entire show in a cat suit with a camera facing me.
PVC catsuit, right? The whole nine yards.
Of course.
Laura, I'm missing you now because I know what your face will be, but you cannot miss that show, I'm telling you. You cannot miss that show.
Yeah, that will be the one show where I do all my forfeits in one go. It'll be the catsuit, it'll be the sign, it'll be everything. I'll be here, I'll do it. And then straight after that, go and do Comic-Con in whatever catsuit or whatever Michael decides is the case.
How many
and
you have to go home. Gonna have? I'm going to dress up as one.
You
okay.
want to dress up?
Yeah.
Okay,
you have to go home in your catsuit as well.
Sure. Okay. You know, hey, I've done worse.
Yeah. Probably.
You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus Iacco.
And I'm David Campbell.
With us in the studio is producer, actress, producer, ambassador for Dior, Diane Paras, who we're going to talk more about in your project. We're going to talk about it in a few minutes. In a few minutes, we're going to talk about it now. It's Spotlight. So, send in your questions to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM on Facebook or on Twitter, which is at STB_ResonanceFM or on Instagram. I don't know. Can people send messages on Instagram? I've never really tried it. You don't really say. You send pictures on Instagram. Send us your pictures on Instagram if you want to. And put the hashtag, it's all about the three-way. Or hashtag, Shoot the Breeze Show. Hashtag, Diane Paras. Hi, Diane. How are you?
Hey, how are you?
Doing very well. Doing very well. Tell us. What have you been doing since the last time we saw you?
Yeah, it's been quite a long time, actually.
It has. Easily a year, right?
Oh, yeah. I think so, too. Yeah. Well, quite a few things happening. Ambassador for Dior, and as one of their new faces. And at the same time, I got the chance to invite it pretty much like a month ago, back in May, when the John Wick premiere was actually on.
The John Wick premiere, yeah. Okay.
Keanu Reeves. Yeah.
Oh, yes. On a private event. Mm-hmm. So it was quite an experience. I was shaky.
Okay.
And I got the opportunity to actually meet the man.
Meet Keanu Reeves.
Yes. Okay. Briefly, although he was surrounded by God knows how many.
Yeah.
And
he can do no wrong these days. I mean, he's coming back with Bill and Ted. Is Bill and Ted Part 3?
I know, I heard.
Yeah. Yep. That's we're looking forward to that. John Wick 3 basically is breaking. Well, not breaking records, but it's doing very well in the box office.
I have to say,
seen the film?
I did. I prefer the second. Ah, okay. Oh, you should.
Okay.
I prefer the second.
Mm.
A bit more developed plots,
yeah.
Characters. There's a bit more substance. Three is nice, but I think they should do a four now.
Okay. So just keep going and going and going.
Well, to a certain extent. I mean, surely we cannot make that to a Harry Potter, right?
Well, hey, they'll do a prequel for John Wick, right? Which fits perfectly because, I mean, they've built this whole mythology of who John Wick was. I'm not saying it would be great if they did it. I'm just saying it's easy money for them to go and say, right, this is, you know who John Wick is after he retired and so on and so forth. Here's what made him the boogeyman of boogeymen. You know what I mean?
There's always a sequel to the prequel, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah.
So tell us, what does an ambassador for Dior entail?
Interesting question. Quite a few things, actually. Represent the brand, go to fashion events, be the face of the brand at any time, at any given moment, and be there to represent the brand when new launches are on, and be invited to premieres like that, which is a good thing, right?
Do you get any Dior products?
Oh, yeah, of course. Okay. The goodie bags. The so-called goodie bags.
Did you bring anything for us?
I will do.
Okay, fair enough. Next
time you need to tell me.
Next week, Diane Paras is coming back into the studio.
She's gonna be Santa Claus, right?
Yes. Why not? And then tell us on the film front. So the last time you were here, you were here with Charlotte Brown, and you were talking Dracula, The Reign of Dracula.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us more about what's working with that project or with any other projects that you're working on.
As you already know, we were together with Charlie. For personal reasons, we are not together anymore. And we decided to actually split in a way the projects. Mm-hmm. So for the time being, I'm actually concentrating more on my baby?
Sure.
Which is the Macedonia is Greek, which is basically around ancient Greek history, Alexander mainly. And there is a reason why I chose to do that. She was part of the project as well. Mm-hmm. And the main thing behind that project is to bring and raise more awareness about who that guy really was.
Okay. About Alexander the Great.
Exactly.
Okay.
The history of the place, because there's a lot of confusion, a lot of misunderstanding, a lot of misinformation about what the actual history was. A lot of, shall I say, people and politicians, especially down south, Mediterranean, they tried to twist the plots and try to change and alter some events.
So it's a documentary?
Yes.
Oh.
A real-life documentary, and with interviews of certain politicians, archaeologists, and, of course, people who are like you and me, and who know a certain thing or two.
A lot of talking head experts talking about the history of Macedonia, about different things. Okay, okay.
Exactly, because even here, right, when you go to certain universities, there are a lot of people who, and I'm talking about students, I'm not talking about archaeologists, I'm talking about normal students, pretty much... 30 and below that age gap, and they are not that very well aware of who Alexander the Great really was. You pose a question and they will look at you for 5-10 minutes and they will start thinking, wait, hold on, which part of the world? And let me guess, is this part of the world? Oh yeah, no, he's Macedonian. There's this, oh no, he's Greek. And I'm saying, okay, there's the part that needs to be clarified.
So for those people who are listening right now who have no idea who Alexander the Great is, was, tell us, who is Alexander the Great? Who was Alexander the Great?
Well, let's just start by saying that he was actually born in Greek territory, which a lot of people actually dispute nowadays. And he was born in Pella, which was part of the, shall I say, Greek Macedonia.
Mm-hmm.
There was only one Macedonia back then. It covered quite a lot of areas, including some areas up in the north, including other states, but other countries now.
Yeah.
And the reason why this, shall I say, documentary takes place and will take place shortly is because... simply, due to an unfortunate political situation in Greece during the past 2-3 years, I would say, there was quite a lot of dispute about the name Macedonia, about what the origins of the name of Macedonia was. And to a certain extent, with the, shall I say, help, in inverted commas, of certain Greek politicians, history was tried to alter and change. Thank God for historical books and archaeologists challenge that, and there is the proof, the evidence throughout history.
So Macedonia is experiencing a crisis in culture, in a sense.
Pretty much.
Some people are trying to define or are trying to alter what is historical fact, if you will.
In a way, yes.
Okay. So does that tie into Alexander the Great, or is that just sort of a part of the documentary? So you'll do a little bit about that, a subsection, and then the focus will be mainly about Macedonia itself?
Mainly about Macedonia itself, but because Macedonia is actually connected to Alexander and Alexander to Macedonia, these two are pretty much like a strong link together. You cannot have one without the other and vice versa.
Okay.
So it's very crucial for the historical facts to put across, and for people to know exactly where they stand, what they know, what they are being taught.
Okay.
And I believe, especially nowadays, because there is a huge... and this is my understanding, there's a huge crisis with regards to moral standards and values. Not a lot of people know history. Not a lot of people know exactly who you are, who you were, where you come from, and the history of your place. And I believe, to a certain extent, is if you know who you are, you know who, where you're going.
Sure.
You know your identity to a certain extent.
Is that expression, you need to know where you came from in order to know where you're going? I think something...
I butchered that saying,
but something along those lines.
Yes.
Okay, you listen to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
With us in the studio. Yeah, David Campbell, who keeps sneaking in and out. You think people can't see you and people can't hear you. People are hearing you sneaking out of the studio.
I'm a working producer.
You're a working producer.
Exactly, and I have to go and do bits and pieces, you know what I mean?
You know what, I have nothing to fault you on, apart from the fact that you've been sneaking out. You haven't been listening to our guest, Diane Paras.
I'm really, really sorry about that, because I've just missed a bit.
Please apologize to our guest.
That's what I'm saying. You were saying it to me.
Please apologize to our guest.
I'm so sorry, Diane.
Apology accepted, really.
Because, you know, like I said, when we started the show, I've been watching, and I recommend this program on iPlayer. It's called Treasures of Ancient Greece, and it's being repeated now, actually, and I'm catching it up from iPlayer. And it's focusing on what happened in ancient Greece from 800 BC right the way up to the time of the Romans and blah, 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 blah. But, yeah, it's going to fill in all the gaps. Well, hopefully it's going to fill in the gaps with regards the people and personalities of the day. So what you're saying, you know, makes a lot of sense as far as I'm concerned.
Funny enough, because the chronology you actually gave me just now, mm-hmm. it actually fits partly with Alexander's history as well.
Yeah.
Well, mm-hmm. this is in within that time frame in a way.
Yeah.
And this project's called Macedonia is Greek.
Yes.
Okay. You meant... Oh, sorry, go on.
No. I was going to say that when we were working, when we were together with Charlie on the project, when we started putting it out, it got quite a lot of attention, mm-hmm. and it was nominated actually for two awards at the Olympus Film Festival in L.A.
Well, so Macedonia is Greek.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Best directing and best original, in a way, shall I say, screenplay.
So has it already been made?
No, some parts, because some festivals actually want the full piece. Some festivals want just segments. Mm-hmm. So what it was introduced back then, it was just segments and just the synopsis of the
Of the project. Okay.
So now it's more to come, and the final piece needs to come together before it's submitted to more.
Oh, okay. Oh, so you're still working with Charlotte Brown on the project?
No.
Oh, okay.
Now I'm doing it myself.
Okay.
And with a Greek team.
Okay. I don't know, because it's sort of, I got a little confused at the Okay, so it's
when
gone.
She was on the project,
yes.
Then that's the stage we got to, and then by the time she was off, mm-hmm. then basically from that point on, it's basically down to me and my efforts and basically the great team there.
So it's a new project now, or is
no,
it sort of
it's
a continuation?
The same project. Okay. It's a continuation to in a way finish the final bits and pieces, the final parts in a way of the real life documentary about the history.
Okay, fair enough. The only reason I asked that was because you were mentioning about the fact that it's as a documentary, you're going and exploring the various aspects of stories being told from different parts, and how Macedonia is Greek is sort of Macedonia itself is having that challenge with politicians who are trying to change the history and everything. And as you mentioned just now, that the initial sections that have already been made of the documentary itself have already they've won awards in different places, and now you're getting that back, and you're sort of expanding on that same project.
Finishing in a way from that point, finishing whatever is left to finish.
Sure, yeah. And it just again, because one of the things because we have a number of people who come in here, a number of producers who come in, and they talk to us about one of the issues we talked about a couple of weeks ago was about agents and actors' rights and whatnot, and we get a lot of people who ask questions about that, about mm-hmm. sort of the legalities behind. You know, rights of copyright of work and so on. So it's sort of how did you deal with the separation in that situation where Charlotte Brown, who was working on the project, has now moved away from the project and you're now taking that onwards?
No, it was a mutual decision.
Okay.
Because as you already know, we had two projects together.
Yeah, that and Reign of Dracula. Yes.
So Reign of Dracula is hers, Macedonia mm-hmm. is Greek is mine.
Okay.
So it was more of a fair share of a split deal, shall I say. And we're still in the process of splitting it up.
Sure.
But we understand the rights of each other, so we respect each other to that extent.
Okay.
So we try to, shall I say, keep it more professional.
No, that makes sense. Okay. So are you now doing this as a project in the UK, or are you going over to, are you going to shoot this on location in Macedonia?
Both, because I actually have some interviews from here as well with certain universities from the archaeological departments. Mm-hmm. So this is going to be pieced together, put together with certain interviews from the Greek element, shall I say, with certain politicians and certain archaeological teams there. So when the final piece of that part is done, mm-hmm. then it's going to be edited to be submitted.
Okay, so and then the parts that you've done already, is there a way that our viewers, our listeners, could actually get to see this and learn a little bit more about the project and then go to see the full...
The parts that are filmed at the moment, for the time being, we are not allowed to put it out due to certain, just like you said, copyrights.
Okay.
About the festival. So
sure.
I think it's going to be sometime in September when I will be able to actually partly really certain aspects of it on YouTube and in probably Instagram and some other avenues.
So is it still going around in festivals?
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
Because there is another one in September and October.
Sure. Which festival is that?
The one in Toronto, Canada. So and
nowhere local then?
No. Funny enough, none of them were actually local. Mm. We actually looked into it. I remember when Charlotte was on board, but I think the deadline was not actually convenient.
Sure.
So we never actually looked into that avenue of submitting it to something in the UK. Okay. I don't know if anybody would be interested from the UK side to do that.
Let me throw this to David. Producer David has come back into the studio. David, I want to ask you, you were talking a couple of episodes ago about some of the festivals that are going on at the moment in London.
Free festivals, yes.
Do you remember any of the ones that are local that may possibly take documentaries as well that we can recommend to Diana?
Those free festivals mainly are just showing films that have already been out for several years, if you see what I mean. So, for instance, the one that was talking about in Lewisham, all the films had been released 4 or 5 years ago. Hence the reason why it's free, because there's not that much in the way of copyright, blah, 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 and all that stuff. With regards to other festivals, I'm not too sure, but we can always have check. I can always check in and let you know afterwards.
History UC is a very, very specific project and a very specific subject to be concentrated on. People are more into indie films, more short films, or more like full-length films.
Sure.
That's why I said there has to be a bit more awareness about, not necessarily ancient Greek history, but since ancient Greek history is our subject now, people need to be more aware of, their origins, about who they are.
Yeah.
How they came to be. And it's always very nice because you actually tend to see some part of your roots and who you are. Who you are and where you're going in the future. Yeah.
So how far along in the project are you?
Pretty much halfway through.
Oh, so we can, if I don't want to put a timeline on it, when we can see the...
Don't put a timeline.
I'm not putting a timeline.
But I have to say, I am on a timeline, because September, October, it has to be pretty much the end of it.
Yes.
Because it has to be submitted. So the interest that I get from certain festivals and that the fact that they need it, so that gives me pretty much of a tight time frame to work on.
So you're looking at September, October to have the full film finished.
Yeah.
Not the one that is, because at the moment you said you've got that project right now, the one that's the short with Charlotte Brown that you're moving away from.
Yeah.
And the full project is going to be available in September, October.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's fine. So that's great. We can at least look forward to seeing in September, October. We would love it if you send us a copy so that we can listen to it. And we can promote it a little bit more on the show. We can talk more about it. David, producer David, when he's sitting down and actually concentrating on what he's supposed to be doing, can recommend some festivals they can go to. Thank you very much, Dan. Please stay with us. We're going to have our next segment, which is top five favorite categories, top five favorites. Top five category this week is going to be films and TV shows about the history of Greece. So we're going to do really quickly.
Ancient Greece.
What did I say?
History of Greece.
I said history of Greece.
Yeah.
What's the difference?
We're having a dispute now. You see how the dispute comes along.
I say history of Greece. You say ancient Greece.
Yeah, well, not history. All films are histories. They're just about a certain period.
Don't be ageist. Okay, right. Don't be ageist. Right, calling people ancient just because they're older than you are. What is wrong with you, producer David? Anyway, we're going to be talking films and television shows about ancient Greece. You happy now, David?
Yeah, sure.
We're going to go around the room. Our guest, Diane, will do her number five and number four. Then David will do his number five and four. I'll do my number five and four until we get to number one. So, Diane, what five and four have you brought for us today?
Okay, five. Although it's not actually an ancient Greek personality, but it's connected to ancient Greece. Hence the reason why I was saying know your origins and know your roots. Cleopatra with Elizabeth Taylor.
Cleopatra?
Yep.
I'm sure she was Egyptian.
Aha, that's what you don't know. You see history.
We're going to learn something.
Yes, yeah. We're going to learn something. So, how is Cleopatra connected to Greece?
She was actually one of the descendants of the Ptolemy dynasty.
Okay.
Which was, Ptolemy was actually one of the generals of Alexander the Great, you see?
I said okay, but it's a reflex. I had no idea what you... Okay, sure. Okay, so I did not know that. Okay.
So that's a little piece of information there.
We've learned something new. Okay, yep. What's your number four?
Troy.
Troy.
With Brad Pitt, obvious choice.
I'm over Clooney man myself.
Are you? Yeah. Too bad he hasn't done anything about ancient Greece though.
That's true.
Yet,
actually, we're gonna go down a rabbit hole. I was gonna say I'm more of a Chris Pratt man myself. Okay. Anyway, David, what's your number five and number four?
Number five is 300, obviously.
300. we played a little clip on the intro. Yeah, the beginning. Yes.
Leonides and you know whatnot and all those perfect buds. perfectly painted on buds. Yep.
Hey, they worked really hard to get that body.
Of course they did. Yes. And then just to wrap it all off, they painted on all those six.
Only to make it a little bit. Yeah, but have you seen the work? We won't even go there. No, but yes, you're right. Those bodies were painted on. If you're listening, Michael Fassbender, David Campbell doesn't think that you actually did enough
it's
work.
Well
out
known,
it's
not. It's anyway, well known.
Anyway, yeah. What's your number four?
I've just actually changed this, actually. So it's, my number four is Time Bandits.
Time Bandits. That's I keep saying it's the Monty Python one. It's not a Monty Terry Python. Terry Gilliam. Yes. Yeah.
And you know that it features the young Matt, young boy who's nicked by several different dwarves who are little men who are going through time, thieving ancient
artifacts,
and they do meet Agamemnon and what have you. Hence the reason why I've chosen that one.
Okay, so your number five was 300. Number four was Time Bandits. Yep. Okay, so I'm gonna get stoned because my number five was My Big Fat Greek Wedding, which is it's not exactly on point, but when I think Greece, that's what I think. That's not.
You told me about that once. Okay,
I know. I really like the film.
You like the film.
I like the film. Yes, the second one so much, but the first one was good. I really enjoyed it.
What connects that film with what's it called again? Whoopi Goldberg.
What connects that film with Whoopi Goldberg?
Yeah.
I have no idea.
One of the stars.
One of the stars. Okay.
I can't remember. Oh God, she plays one of the nun, the big nun, in that film.
And she's not in it.
Yeah, she is.
She's sister not
act.
In it.
Sister act.
Yeah, sister act.
Nia
Vardalos.
No, not Nia Vardalos. She's the main. She's the main actress. I know the one you're talking about. She's not in it.
I'm gonna look that up.
You look that up. You look that up.
I remember seeing that. I'm thinking,
trying to challenge me on my film trivia, and it's like, well, you come correct, man. Check it out. I think you're wrong. I know who you're talking about, but I think you're wrong. I don't think it's her. Anyway, we'll check it out. Anyway, so that's my number five. My number four, I already mentioned, 300. So if you haven't seen 300, honestly, Zack Snyder's it wasn't his debut because Dawn of the Dead was his debut. It was the second one after that, and I really like 300. Really, really like it. Pumps me up every time I need to go to the gym, which is rarely never. Anyway, you're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
With us in the studio is actress, producer, and ambassador for Dior, Diane Paras, who's here to tell us about her number three and two films about ancient Greece.
Three, I would put Alexander. Too bad I should have put it first, but it wasn't such an obvious choice.
This is the Oliver
Colin
Stone.
Farrell. Yes, exactly.
Okay.
And number two, 300, Rise of an Empire.
You prefer the second one?
No, because I put 300 as a first.
Don't tell us what that is. Actually, yeah, okay. So Rise 300.
Funny enough, I didn't actually realize that they'd made a sequel to the first 300.
Yes.
No, I haven't seen Rise of the Empire.
Tell us why is 300 Rise of what is it
Rise of an Empire.
So why was that so good that it's your number two?
Well, it's pretty much like a continuation of 300, the original with Gerard Butler.
Yes.
I shall call him Leonidas, but okay, Gerard Butler. Fine. Yes,
you
still
can say Leonidas.
Still.
It's fine. Yeah. It focuses on the not the Spartans anymore. It focuses on the Arcadians, right?
Actually, the story, the Battle of
Thermopylae. Sorry, yes, my bad.
Themistocles, and pretty much how the whole battle came to be, how the Spartans actually got involved in the battle, because in the beginning they didn't want to.
Sure.
Don't get me wrong, some historical inaccuracies were just like with any other movie.
Of course.
But it gives a very nice round picture of how the battle came to be, and pretty much I like it because 300, and then you have the continuation of that.
Yeah, it kind of it fits in right in the middle, because you see a bit just before 300, and then at the end you see sort of the continuation. It's kind of like a prequel and a sequel of 300, because you see a bit before, and then at the end of it you see the end of what happens after 300 ends, and so on and so forth. So
exactly, and not only that, we have here, which was very prominent on 300, and then we have it again on 300 Rise of an Empire. We have the I'm not gonna be judgmental, but the so-called the evil part, which was the Persian Empire back then.
Yes.
And we see how their king was actually portrayed on both films.
Yes.
And the kind of impression it made. You have the Greek Empire, you have the Persian Empire, and the dynamic between the two.
Okay. Well, you know what? I will give 300 Rise of an Empire a second shot and go and watch it again. David, what's your number three? What's your number two?
I'm going to eat crow because I just looked it up and...
Yes! I'm sorry. What were you saying, David? I missed what you just said. Go on, please. Say it again.
I said I was wrong.
You were wrong about what specifically?
You know very well what
I'm
I was wrong
I'm
about.
Sorry. Diane, do you know what he's talking about?
No, I've not.
I don't know.
I said, there's no need for me to expand then, is there?
Is it the fact that you found out that your tenuous link between Whoopi Goldberg
that is,
and...
Yes, that is exactly what I was apologizing for. Yeah. I was wrong. So, you know, I erred.
Okay.
I made a mistake.
You know what? I forgive you. It's okay. What's your number three and your number two?
My number three is Spartacus.
Spartacus.
And one of the things one of the reasons why I chose this one, because it wasn't really obvious to me that Spartacus was actually Greek, but he's Thracian.
Yes.
And that was part of the ancient Greek land, which is now split between three countries.
Good. Somebody did his homework.
Yeah, I did some homework. So it's split between Greece, Bulgaria, and Turkey. That's it. That's the three. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, but in the ancient times, it was part of the ancient
Greek territory.
Yeah, Greek territory. Okay. So, yeah, and everyone knows what Spartacus is all about.
Of course.
And I'm talking about the film, not the
TV series. Sure.
TV series, I have watched one or two episodes, but because it's on at odd times and I don't always think about it, I've missed so many episodes, I'd have to sort of like see it somewhere on catch up so I can sit down and watch it properly through. So,
okay, so that was your number three.
That was my number three. My number two, Jason and the Argonauts.
Oh my word, okay, that takes me back.
Jason and the Argonauts.
All I will say to that is Ray Harryhausen, that man and his stuff is just genius.
That's the only thing I remember about that film. That's the only thing. Is that the one where he's fighting the skeletons? Or am I thinking of a different one?
No, that's the one.
That's the one.
And you know, everyone thinks about that scene because it was brilliant. It was mind-blowing. It's such a really, really good scene, but it's also a really good really good story anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Jason going off to find
to the Golden Fleece.
Golden Fleece defeating the Gorgon?
The Gorgon, yes. Yeah,
chopping off her head and da da da. Excellent.
Wait, chopping off her head?
It's it.
Yeah. The chopping off her head will come in my list in a few minutes. So anyway, we'll come back to that. Yeah. Anyway, my number three, you talked about Spartacus the film. I want to talk about Spartacus the TV series because I watched every single episode of it, baby.
And it was amazing. Listen to this guy boasting.
Oh, man.
How many episodes?
There were five seasons, I believe. Four or five seasons.
So
I can't remember.
20 per season, so that's about 120.
Yeah. Was it 20 episodes? Maybe 20 episodes. I need to recheck it to be sure. Probably 12. I think they went with 12 episodes because it was Showtime, so it wasn't. It's not your regular whatever. But no, not Showtime. Stars. I can't remember the name of the actor who plays Spartacus in the TV series, great guy.
Didn't he die?
He did. Yes, he died at the. Yeah. They did the first season. They had to cut his character back in the second season because he had cancer. Mm. And just towards the end of the second season, it seemed like he'd gone to remission. So they were like, excellent, they'll carry on doing it. And he then died. And then they replaced him. And I have to admit, the actor they replaced him with, I can't remember his name either, not as good, but either way, I was already hook, line, and sinker in the show. Mm-hmm. Loved it for all the other characters. I'm terrible with names, but he plays Crixus. And he's been in different other shows. Everyone else is yelling at me saying, yeah, he was in the Arrow show, in the Arrow TV series as Slade Wilson, a.k.a. not Deadpool, but the other character, Dead something? It doesn't matter. Anyway, yes, Crixus, I know him from there. I know him from other stuff. Some of the actors actually from 300, like the one who says, this is madness, and he gets kicked into the pit by Leonidas in 300. He's in it as well as the character. Anyway, great show. You should go back and watch it. Anyway, that's 300.
No, I didn't say I wasn't going to. I said I just haven't got to it yet.
And it's also stylistically done the same way as 300.
I remember that, yes. Yes. Yeah.
So that was a Spartacus, the TV series. I was going to put Hercules and Xena the Prince's Warrior, but I was afraid Diana would stab me in the neck. So I crossed that out and I put Spartacus TV series.
Well, you couldn't put that in there anyway. Hercules is a Roman god.
I know.
Oh, demigod.
As you said.
It's Heracles. Heracles is the Greek.
Okay,
god.
We need another show for that.
Wait, to talk about that.
We need another show.
I sidestepped that argument, so we'll.
There's no argument.
My number two, and again, it's not about ancient Greece, but it kind of delves into the Greek culture. Zorba the Greek.
Oh my god.
Anthony Quinn. It's way back when, I think 60s or 50s, I can't remember when, but it was way back. It's about a British, a half British, half Greek writer who goes back to Greece to sort of kind of like dislodge his writer's block as well as take over a mine. And he meets this character called Zorba, who's Greek, obviously played by Anthony Quinn. And he's a force of nature. He breezes in and he's passionate and romantic and spare of the moment, and literally he can lead a crowd into he can get a crowd to do anything he wants, and those kind of characters really grab me, you know what I mean? It's like when he's
the very passionate, yes, very fiery, very dynamic characters, right?
Yes, and they're very there's a word for it. It's escaped my memory, but yes, they can move a crowd. And yes, and I love Anthony Quinn, and he's dead now, but yeah, he was a great actor. I grew up watching his stuff, and yeah, so Zorba the Greek is my number two.
Yeah, that was on TV so often, it was untrue.
Yeah, like a Channel 4 and like 1 p.m. or something like that.
Well,
yeah.
No, it wasn't Channel 4, it would be BBC 2 or ITV.
Oh yeah, sorry, ITV, yeah, but yeah.
At that point.
In the afternoons, yeah.
Exactly.
You're listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. I'm Marcus Iacco.
And I'm David Campbell.
With us in the studio, about to tell us her number one film about ancient Greece is Diana Karras. What's your number one?
I already gave it away.
You did.
Yeah,
but go on, tell us again for those people that weren't listening.
Yeah, 300. And not for the obvious reasons, right?
What? Yeah, the swordplay and the reasons?
Yeah, the physique. But
I watched it for the physique, I'm just saying.
And you're a man.
Gerard Butler. What? It's the Scottish accent.
I think I just enjoyed watching it. It was just hysterical, to be quite honest. I was just looking at them and thinking, yeah, you did how many crunches per day to get that body?
You finished watching the film, they turn around to David and like, David, what's the film about? I have no idea, but Michael Fassbender is divine.
I just turned around and looked at him and thought, he was in it?
Yeah.
No, he wasn't.
You weren't even looking at faces. It was like body here.
There was body here. Body there. No, there was...
This body said to the other body something
guy,
about...
This guy
Spartan.
Went pit, you know what I mean?
Yeah, this good-looking body fell into that hole, and then this other good-looking body started meshing with that other good-looking body, and everything was all...
It's funny that women actually went to see that movie just because of that, just and men actually went to see it for
the story.
Reasons.
Yeah. For the story.
For the story, yeah, okay, yes. We can call it the story.
That's what I went to go see. Yeah. I went to go learn about the history of how Persia did not conquer Greece. That's why I went to go see. I don't know what you guys are talking about, but yeah. So 300 is your number one. David, what's your number one?
Ray Harryhausen again.
Okay.
Clash of the Titans.
Oh, yes.
Harry Hamlin. Ray Harry.
I'm glad you started off by saying Ray Harryhausen, because I was going to say, oh, you mean the Sam Worthington one? It was like 2001.
No. Funny enough, I actually only managed to sit halfway through that, and I thought to myself, no, man, it's just not the same.
Sure,
it's not the same. Clash of the Titans is just brilliant.
That's your number one.
Yeah, it's okay. my number one. Do I need to expand?
Not particularly, because that's my number one too.
Oh, really?
So, yeah.
Oh.
Absolutely. I grew up watching it. It's like tons and tons of times watching it until the tape wore out and then got the opportunity. I actually saw the remake, and here's what I recommend. Watch the remake on DVD especially. Not on TV. Watch it on DVD. Here's why. When you finish watching the movie, watch the deleted scenes. I feel sorry for Luke Evans, because Luke Evans plays a character, I can't remember which character he plays in it, but if you watch the full movie, he's literally like a blink and you miss a cameo. You watch the deleted scenes, he must have slept with the director's wife, because they cut him out of that movie. They surgically removed him from that movie.
Really?
Tons of scenes where he's doing a monologue, and he's basically passionate and explaining to this woman, I can't remember who she is, why the humans should be spared and why Zeus is overreacting. And Zeus comes in and he's like, you are overreacting, God of all gods. You should know. And he's giving it his all cut out.
How much time would all those scenes
easily add together? Easily 15 minutes. You can imagine there were 20 different deleted scenes in there.
Mm-hmm.
19 of them were Luke Evans. I kid you not. Go and check it out, just for that. Because I watched it and just like, there must have been, because when you're watching the full film, right, there are scenes where decisions are made where it's like, what? That doesn't make sense.
Yeah,
so. Exactly. It's like Zeus goes in and helps Perseus at one point, and the very next scene, it's like he's in a different outfit, and it's like his twin brother steps up and says, release the Kraken. Liam Neeson, obviously.
Famous line.
Exactly. When you watch the deleted scenes, it's not Liam Neeson's, it's not Zeus that goes down and talks to Perseus. It's Luke Evans' character that goes and talks to Perseus. So I'm like, yeah, you slept with the director's wife. That's the only explanation I can give.
Nah, it can't be that. He might have done something else.
Hey, have you seen Luke Evans? He's a handsome man.
No. There might have been a really, really good reason for it. You know.
Sure. So, yeah. I think sleeping with the director's wife is a good enough reason to get cut out of the film.
How do you know the director had a wife at the time?
I don't know. I'm just making this up.
Exactly.
Okay, fine. Slept with the director's husband or boyfriend or girlfriend or dog. I don't know. He did something that really annoyed the director, and the director decided, no, you are out of my movie, and just slashed him and then kept the deleted scenes. That would be the ultimate insult. It'd be like, look, you're in this film, apart from the fact that you get paid, but that doesn't matter. It's like, well, and the film wasn't that good. But that's the thing. It's the fact that he didn't know that.
Well, that might be the reason why he got cut out, because he requested, he saw the rushes of the film. I said, no, this is going to damage my reputation. Cut me out.
Luke Evans had final cut decision on the film. It was like, right,
just,
sir.
Just take me out.
Yeah, take me out. He's like, no.
I'll give you back the money.
Yeah. He's like, no, but you're part of it. He's like, I'll sleep with your wife. You're gone. That's fine. You've been listening to Shoot the Breeze on Resonance 104.4 FM. Diane, I want to say thank you very much for coming back in.
Thank you for having me.
And as soon as you've got the project up and running, please let us know.
Oh, I will.
And we can talk more about the project then. You've been listening to Shoot the Breeze. I'm Marcus E. Acko.
And I'm David Campbell.
Saying thank you very much for listening.
See you next week.
You got it right this time. So you can still listen if you want to. Listen to this. Have you got some music playing after this?
Yeah, I've got some music playing.
Have you got with you the music I asked you to play?
Yes, I have.
Cool. Excellent.
But I'm going to have to play something else as well.
No, that's fine. You're going to play something else. That's fine. It's
as
okay.
As well,
of course. It's okay. Obviously, YouTube are probably going to yank this episode because of this little clip. But I don't care.